1973. Okay. Unquestionably, much of the success enjoyed by the Jesuit missionaries at Nulato is attributable to the fact that from the beginning, they regarded communication as the most crucial aspect of their efforts. Upon arriving in the Middle Yukon, the pioneer missionaries applied themselves to learning the language Athabascan. Soon, grammars, dictionaries, catechisms, prayer books, hymnals, and translations of scriptural liturgical texts were produced in the native language. The emphasis from the outset on formal schooling contributed to their success. Later, missionaries who were not fluent in Athabascan had written materials at their disposal, and a generation of native people to communicate with the new English. The stumbling block between missionaries and Nulato natives was not the language barrier, but a misunderstanding on the part of the missionaries of traditional native culture ceremonies, especially of the stick dance or the Feast of the Dead. The village of Holy Cross, Alaska grew up around a mission located on the right bank of the Yukon River, 279 miles upstream from the Bering Sea. Before Holy Cross Mission was established, the site was, according to Father Aloysius Ribot, a perfect wilderness. At Holy Cross, the Athabascan Indians of the interior meet the central Yupik Eskimos of the Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta. Holy Cross was actually the second mission founded in northern Alaska. The Nulato Mission was founded the year before. And the name Holy Cross was given to the mission by Father in compliance with the express wishes of Lewis A. Lutens, a one-time bishop of Idaho, then retired in Victoria, who had given Archbishop Sager's party before it left Victoria his pectoral cross containing a relic of the true cross, with the desire that the first mission to be founded in northern Alaska be given the name Mission of the Holy Cross. I can't hear. On September 8th, the Sisters of St. Anne moved into the first log cabin built at Holy Cross. This had been intended for Jesuits, but was hastily finished and given to the sisters for temporary use. By January 9th, the Holy Cross Mission School had 31 pupils, day scholars, and boarders. Before the end of September 1889, a much-needed new schoolhouse was ready, and boarders came from various villages up and down the Yukon and from the Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta area. In 1938, Holy Cross celebrated its Golden Jubilee. In a booklet produced on that occasion, the following statistics are given. Number of pupils admitted, 983. Number of baptisms performed, 1,439. Number of first communicants, 1,187. Number of confirmations, 937. And number of deaths among mission children, 106. The Holy Cross Mission Boarding School was officially closed on the Feast of the Exaltation of the Holy Cross, September 14th, 1956. The school opened in 1888, it had seen the service of 95 different Jesuits, 28 brothers, 42 priests, and 58 different Sisters of St. Anne, a total of 1,457 children, 727 boys and 730 girls had been cared for at the mission. The first Catholic mission among the Eskimos in Alaska was founded in 1889 at the village of Tinunik on Nelson Island. From the very beginning of that mission, it was hoped that the school would be a part of it. The school at Holy Cross Mission, which was serving mainly Indian children in predominantly Indian country, prompted the Jesuits to intensify their efforts to bring into being a similar school in Eskimo territory. However, the remoteness of Nelson Island relative to other Jesuit missionary activity made it difficult to supply and ill-suited to serve as a center of missionary activity in a district stretching along the Bering Sea coast from the mouth of the Yukon to that island. Accordingly, in 1892, the mission station was relocated to the bank of the Akularak River. During its first year, St. Mary's Mission operated only a day school. The boarding school opened in 1906. The diphtheria epidemic that swept the coast in 1906 killed many people and left in its wake many orphans. There was now no longer a shortage of children to be cared for and schooled. At first, Only girls attended the boarding school, and beginning in 1914, boys too began to be admitted. Boarders at St. Mary's generally numbered between 75 to 100, and usually girls outnumbered boys by a large margin. As a rule, children stayed at St. Mary's for an average of about 5 years. Some, especially orphans, stayed as long as 10 to 16 years. The great influenza epidemic of 1918 likewise left many orphans for whom St. Mary's offered providential care. Bishop Cremant. The year 1917 was a year of major importance, not just for Father Cremant, but also the church in Alaska. On December 22, 1916, Alaska was raised to that of a vicariate apostolic, and on February 15, 1917, Father Cremant, as was to be expected, was appointed Vicar Apostolic of Alaska. When he first received word that he was to be Alaska's first bishop, he wrote to his superior, "If it's God's will to glorify himself in me by choosing this helpless pauper and raising him from the dust and placing him among the princes of the church, let it be so. I did not ask for it, nor expect it. I am not scared, and do not refuse it." On the 14th of August, 1875, Joseph entered the Jesuit novitiate. His health at this time was so poor, there was little hope for his life. A doctor examined him and gave him less than a month to live. Just at this time, Don Bosco, the apostle of the youth and founder of the Salesian order, came to where Joseph was stationed to establish there an institute for poor boys. Joseph was appointed to serve the Mass, and after the Mass, Joseph said to him, "Father Bosco, I have a favor of you." He went on then to tell him of his hopes of one day becoming a missionary and of the doctor's verdict that there was no hope for him. Father Bosco, since canonized, assured him of his prayers and that Joseph's hope of becoming a missionary would one day be realized.
If you have a bunch of children out there in the audience, there's ladies upstairs doing face painting for them in the blue room.
Okay. So they're waiting. There are, if there's children that are looking for entertainment, there's up in the blue room upstairs, there's face painting and balloons, I believe. Yeah. Okay. On October 1938, Bishop Cremant had the joy of blessing and laying the cornerstone of the chapel at the Shrine of St. Teresa near Juneau. A year later, on October 26, 1941, he offered the first Mass in it. It was in the crypt beneath this chapel that this great Christian man, predicted by Don Bosco to be a missionary, found his final resting place. On July 29, 1942, Bishop Cremant, now the oldest bishop in America, celebrated his Silver Episcopal Jubilee in St. James Cathedral, Seattle, where he'd been consecrated a bishop 25 years previously. 3 years later, at the age of 87, in St. Anne's Hospital, Juneau, on May 20th, 1945, he died. The governor of Alaska at that time, Ernest Gruening, hailing Bishop Cremant as a great Christian man, ordered flags throughout Alaska to be flown at half mast for 3 days. In 1902, gold was discovered in the Tanana Valley, near what is today Fairbanks, and soon the rush was on. Father Francis Monroe was anxious to follow the crowd there in order to establish the church in an already rapidly mushrooming town. In Fairbanks, Father Monroe, standing alone on the banks of the Chena River, found himself penniless, landless, and forlorn. Immediately, he set about raising money. On the south side of the Chena, he found suitable land. In his young days in France, he'd shown himself to be an excellent carpenter. On the Feast of All Saints on November 1st, 1904, Immaculate Conception Church was opened for public service. In 1906, Father Monroe built St. Joseph's Hospital in Fairbanks. It was located on the north side of the Chena and a little downstream from the church where he lived. The 40-bed hospital was ready to admit its first patients, 35 of them. Sisters of St. Anne were part of the hospital staff from September 30th, 1906 to June 23rd, 1907, and they were replaced by the Benedictine sisters, who helped staff the hospital for the next 3 years. On October 1st, 1910, the Sisters of Providence took charge of the St. Joseph Hospital, and they operated and staffed it until it closed in 1968. When the church and the hospital With the church and the hospital on different sides of the Chena, Father Monroe found himself spending too much time commuting between them. The two structures needed to be moved side by side. And in 1909, he discussed the problem with Father Cremant, Bishop Father Joseph Cremant. His superior said, "Move the church." Though not a professional engineer, Father Monroe determined that the church could be moved across the river and next to the hospital. And this is how he did it. When the Chena froze solid enough to bear the weight of the church, he drew two parallel lines 30 feet apart on the ice. Holes were cut through the ice at 8-foot intervals, upright logs wedged into these holes, and the following day the tops were sawed off 2 feet above the ice, making strong supports for heavy timbers. On these the church was rolled diagonally, some 400 feet across the Rosen River to its present site. By 1939, Father Monroe was almost 85 years old and had spent 46 years in the North. On an afternoon of January 9th, 1940, he passed quietly and peacefully away. Father Francis Monroe, the Alaskan Hercules, lies buried in the Jesuit cemetery at Mount St. Michael's. Named for Father Monroe, Monroe Catholic High School had its beginnings, as did the grade school, in the basement of Immaculate Conception Church in the fall of 1955, with an enrollment of 9 students in the freshman class. On September 2nd, 1956, the new high school, built next to the grade school, was dedicated and ready to receive its first freshman and sophomore class, numbering 32. In October 1917, the Pilgrim Hot Springs Ranch on the Pilgrim River, some 60 miles north of Nome, became the property of the Nome Parish. The intentions were to convert it into a mission center with a boarding school and orphanage. Little did anyone realize at the time that just 1 year later there would be, owing to the great influenza epidemic of 1918, orphans in abundance. The first of many sick and orphaned began to arrive at the improvised mission hospital and orphanage in the late fall of 1918. Throughout the first 8 months, orphans kept arriving at the Pilgrim Hot Springs Mission. For August 16th of that year, the mission diary marked a notable event, the arrival, namely, of 5 Ursuline nuns who came to look after the little orphans. During the 22 years that Pilgrim Hot Springs Mission was open, 20 different Ursuline sisters came and went. By 1941, the buildings at the springs were in very poor repair. Furthermore, firewood in the area had become scarce, and most important of all, there were no longer enough orphans to justify the considerable expense of keeping the mission open. It was closed on July 31st, 1941, by Father Edmund A. Annabell. Time? Are we on time? We have plenty? You're finished? Oh. Bishop Francis Gleason. He was the last vicar apostolic of all Alaska. He was the first ordinary in the Diocese of Fairbanks. Francis Doyle Gleason was born in Missouri on January 17th, 1895. He attended Gonzaga High School in Spokane, Washington. In 1917, he went on to Mount St. Michael's in Spokane for 3 years, and while at St. Michael's, he frequently helped with the cooking, and for a time, too, he was one of the engravers of headstones marking the burial sites of deceased Jesuits in Mount St. Michael's Cemetery. On January 27th, Father Gleason became rector of St. Francis Xavier Novitiate in Sheridan, Oregon in 1939. There it is said he ran a peaceful ship and taught the classics and specialized in Shakespeare. Father Gleason went on to serve as pastor of St. Stanislaus Parish in Lewiston, Idaho, and as superior of St. Mary's Mission in Washington from 47 to 48. While there, without knowing it at the time, he was appointed on January 8th to replace Bishop Walter J. Fitzgerald as Vicar Apostolic of Alaska. On February 8th, he sent the following telegram to Father Hugh Geary, the Father Superior of the Oregon Province. Received telegram from Denver Register congratulating on appointment and asking for biographical data. Is this a joke or should I take it seriously? F. Gleason. It was no joke. On April 5th, 1948, Francis Doyle Gleason was consecrated bishop, and on May 30th, 1948, in Juneau, installed as the third Vicar Apostolic of Alaska. On his coat of arms, he had for his motto a Latin phrase meaning, "Thy kingdom come."